Alleluia, 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 alleluia. Behold, the King will come, the Lord of the earth, and he himself will lift the yoke of our captivity. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia. The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Luke. One day, as Jesus was teaching, Pharisees and teachers of the law who had come from every village of Galilee and Judea and Jerusalem were sitting there, and the power of the Lord was with them for healing. And some men brought on a stretcher a man who was paralyzed. They were trying to bring him in and set him in his presence. But not finding a way to bring him in because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him on the stretcher through the tiles into the middle in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "As for you, your sins are forgiven." Then the scribes and Pharisees began to ask themselves, "Who is this who speaks blasphemies? Who but God alone can forgive sins?" Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them in reply, "What are you thinking in your hearts? Which is easier to say, 'Your sins are forgiven,' or to say, 'Rise and walk'? But that you may know that the Son of Man has authority on earth to forgive sins," he said to the one who was paralyzed, "I say to you, rise, pick up your stretcher, and go home." He stood up immediately before them, picked up what he had been lying on, and went home glorifying God. Then astonishment seized them all, and they glorified God. And struck with awe, they said, "We have seen incredible things today." The Gospel of the Lord. We've been reading through the prophet Isaiah during the season of Advent, and the prophet Isaiah can be a very difficult and confusing book to read. One of the keys to understanding the prophet Isaiah is that Isaiah is a master poet, right? So oftentimes when we think about the prophets of the Old Testament, right, we think that prophets are future tellers. And the prophets do that in certain cases, but primarily they are speaking God's words in the present, which often entail words of judgment and words of also restoration, right, and hope. And we see this in chapter 35 of the prophet Isaiah. Chapter 34, right, was talking all about the judgment that God was going to bring on the pagan nations who are enemies of Israel. That's why we hear in this passage about God coming with divine recompense, with vindication. You know, vindication is kind of a watered-down translation. A more accurate translation is he comes with vengeance, right? So we picture God coming on the clouds, and the glory of the Lord will be seen when he comes bringing vengeance and vindication to save his people, right? Bringing judgment upon his enemies. But at the same time, we see all of this other poetry from Isaiah about what it will look like when God comes. The desert will exult. The steppe will rejoice and bloom. They will bloom with abundant flowers. In the desert, the burning sands will become pools, and the thirsty ground springs of water. And so it's kind of might remind you of maybe the Garden of Eden, right? Basically, the prophet Isaiah is saying that when the Messiah comes, it's almost like he will be Edenizing the world. Right? All of the sins that the world has endured and that humanity has brought upon the world, right, they will begin to be reversed when the Messiah comes. He is a great bringer of healing and restoration. It's this very chapter that Jesus quotes. Remember when John the Baptist sends his disciples to Jesus to ask if he is the one who is to come, or should they wait for another? And he says, basically, "Have you not read?" Right? Tell John what you see. The lame walk, the mute speak, the deaf here. And he's quoting this passage from Isaiah 35, that he is the great bringer of restoration. You know, something I think that is really profound about this, something that I've always found very profound, is in J.R.R. Tolkien's book, The Lord of the Rings. One of the beautiful things that he portrays in that story, you guys all know Tolkien was a very devout Catholic, and all the greatest warriors in that story, they also end up being the greatest of healers. The most powerful fighters and warriors are the elves and the wizards, and they also happen to be the greatest healers. It's kind of that great mystery of who Christ is. He is the great warrior, right, who rescues us, who ransoms us, who goes to battle with the devil, and yet he is also the great healer, who is always trying to restore us to our original dignity. That's why you see in the lives of the saints, even the effects of sin sometimes no longer have effects on them. Sometimes the saints, when they die, for example, they become incorrupt. They don't decay, right? Saint Jerome, he had a pet lion, right? Even though that many of us, right, because of the effects of sin, right, there are many animals that are dangerous to us. Saint Jerome, because of his holiness, right, the lion was no longer dangerous to him. Right? This is the great reversal and restoration that Christ brings. And in a mystical way, the church is supposed to be the same way out in the midst of the world. Right? We as the body of Christ are to be the great warriors for truth and for God, and yet also the great healers, restoring all the humans around us, right? Trying to restore their original dignity that we were all called to have in the beginning. So as we continue reading through this prophet Isaiah, notice these poetic lines that he is saying. Many of these prophecies are not like a literal fulfillment, as if the Garden of Eden was actually going to come back, but it is a way of describing the effects that Christ and his church has on the world.